In a series called Game Changers, and we've been looking at the book of Joshua. And up to this point in the book of Joshua, we've gone through six chapters, and so far it's been kind of a rah-rah. It's like a, you can do it. It's more like let's go, like be strong and courageous, do not fear. And we talked about last week that victory is guaranteed if you'll stick to God's game plan. We talked about the Battle of Jericho, which wasn't much of a battle, really. Do you recall? Maybe you were here, maybe you weren't here, but if you know about the Battle of Jericho, tell me about it. What happened? They walked. They walked seven times. Thank you, Mason. Okay, so they walked for 7 days. One time around each day. The seventh day they walked how many times?
Seven
times around. And what happened after the seventh time around?
They shouted
and walls came down and they walked right in. They walked straight in. We talked about last week and how victory is ours if we'll stick to the game plan. But we come to chapter 7, and after six chapters of rah-rah, let's go, things change, things shift, and they shift dramatically. And it's really like one word starts us off in chapter 7. It's one word, and it's a very small word, but it makes a huge difference. Some of you, I think, already said it, but. So let's take a look, and as we get ready to dive into Joshua chapter 7, here's our big idea, here's the game changer. Failure is guaranteed if you don't stick to God's game plan. It's so important that we understand this in life. If we don't stick to God's game plan, the result is guaranteed failure. If you want to fail in life, don't stick to God's game plan. Guaranteed, you will get what you want. You will fail. And we will walk through this chapter, and a lot of it's going to be up on the screen. Some of it won't be. I'll kind of just tell you a little bit. We'll read between the lines a little bit, fill you in on some blanks. But I'd love for you to be able to follow along, not just on the screen. If you brought a Bible, great. If you didn't bring one, maybe you have a smartphone or a tablet, and maybe you have the Bible app on there. If you don't have the Bible app on your smartphone or tablet, I would highly encourage you to do so. Tremendous resource. I would also invite you, if you don't have any of the above, grab one of the KWC Bibles from there in front of you, and you can turn to page 155 and be able to follow along with us this morning. But here's the deal. You can just write down on your notes if you haven't already taken them out. Definitely would encourage you to do so. I truly believe God is going to speak to us this morning. Here's what I want us to understand. We could kind of just extrapolate these three words from this sentence. Sin is serious. Okay? To understand, failure is guaranteed if you don't stick to God's game plan. Another way of saying that is sin is serious. We'll talk about failure today as we look at the story of Achan. But the Israelites were unfaithful. This word unfaithful really helps us to see that there's this relationship. There's this relationship between God and the Israelites. It goes back to a covenant. It goes back to an agreement, a relationship that God and the Israelites entered into. And God said, I will be your God and you will be my people. And here are the parameters. It wasn't up to the people to set the parameters because they didn't have anything to really bring to the table. God is God. He does not need anyone. Can we just be okay with that today? Can we get over ourselves and say, God doesn't need me? You're like, Pastor Len, this... Okay, all right, I got one. Can I hear two?
Yes. All right,
they're together, that's good, okay. We've got to get over ourselves. Now, here's the thing, this holiday weekend and all that, and National Paper Airplane Day, and this isn't one of those feel-good sermons for the most part, okay? This is not one of those that you go, wow, I can't wait to preach this in some regards. Because there's some very serious things that are going on here, some difficult things that we're going to have to walk through, talk about today. But I will tell you at the end, there's some hope. But we've got to get through the mess to get to the hope. Okay? They were unfaithful. They broke the relationship. God says, if you do this, then I will bless you. If you will follow me, if you will be obedient to me, I will bless you. I'll be your God. I'll protect you. I'll provide for you. I'll direct you. I'll help you. But if you don't set me apart as God, if you don't follow my decrees, my ways, failure is inevitable. And they were unfaithful. And it says, in regard to the devoted things. Now, what we're getting here in verse 1 is what some people would call reader's advantage or dramatic irony. We're going to get a picture of something. We're going to be told something. We're going to be brought into the knowledge of something that Joshua, basically the main character other than Achan in this chapter, and the Lord, Joshua doesn't know this. The rest of the Israelites don't know this. They're not aware of what we have in verse 1. But they were unfaithful to the devoted things. And if you're reading along in a different translation than in the New International Version, you may find the word accursed things. Because in chapter 6 and in chapter 7, what we have here is devoted will also be translated accursed. Here's the thing. When they went into Jericho, we talked about this last week. It was kind of one of the side notes. Joshua says, when we go in, there's two things that you need to keep in mind. One, don't mess with Rahab's family. Rahab helped us. We're going to help her and her family. We're going to save them. Second, don't touch the devoted things. Don't touch the accursed things. Leave them alone. Don't take them for yourselves. There's going to be some things that we're going to take, and we're going to burn those because they're detestable before the Lord. There's other things that we're going to take, like gold and silver, and we're going to present them all before the Lord. Nothing, as they go into Jerusalem, nothing is to be reserved for them individually. They don't get to take it as a little, you know, souvenir of the Battle of Jericho so they can sell it on eBay sometime later. They don't get to do any of that. It's all for the Lord. We're either going to burn it in recognition of who God is, or we're going to take what is redeemable and put it into the treasury for the Lord. It's devoted to the Lord. I actually like the translation devoted better than accursed, but that's just me. So the devoted things, Achan, which means trouble. Everybody say trouble. So when they say here comes Achan, it's really here comes trouble. And sure enough, Achan is worthy of his name. Now to understand, Achan is most definitely an Israelite. Through and through. Here's his genealogy. Achan, son of Carmi, the son of Zimri, son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah. So we see this lineage going back to the tribe of Judah, one of the 12 tribes. Took some of them. So the Lord's anger burned against Israel. Now Joshua sent men from Jericho, and so we kind of have this backstory of what's something that's taken place that's going to impact the story where we jump into with verse 2. Now Joshua sent men from Jericho. They just defeated Jericho. Now he sends them to Ai or A-E or I. I've heard it pronounced all three different ways. So you can pronounce it any way you want to pronounce it. Okay? What I understand is A-E is the actual pronunciation. So sends them to Ai, which is near Beth Aven to the east of Bethel, and told them, go up and spy out the region. So the men went up and spied out Ai. So they go up and spy out so far it sounds a lot like what they did with Jericho, right? They sent two spies, they sent some spies out, they come back, here's the report. Well, wouldn't you know it, they sent spies out, they come back from AE and they say, you know what? It's a podunk little town. It's like Wilmot. I mean, okay, that's not what they said. It's like, you know what, we don't need a lot of people. They tell Joshua, you know what, don't send a lot of people, don't send everybody. We only need like 2 to 3, maybe 3,000 people tops. Don't send more than that. It'd just be a waste of time. So Joshua says, okay, go ahead, 3,000, about 3,000 troops go up. And wouldn't you know it, they get pummeled. In fact, Scripture tells us that 36 of them died. The rest went running for their lives. And they come back to Joshua, and they're all feeling bad and defeated. And like, what is going on? I mean, we should have won that battle. But there was sin in the camp. Achan had failed. He had taken some of the devoted things. And when you do that, when you fail, failure almost always impacts others. It's so important for us to understand this, that failure almost always, I really wanted to leave almost off of there, and I almost did. But just in case, there might be that one or two anomalies that just, it doesn't happen, but almost always our sin will affect others. Very rarely, if ever, will you find a sin that does not affect somebody else, because life is not lived in a vacuum. And so, you name it, whatever the sin is. Oh, well, pornography. Oh, it's a victimless. No, it's not a victimless crime. That will affect other people. And some of you know very well how that will affect other people. You look at other sins. Lying. How does that affect people? It erodes trust, right? And trust is the foundation of every relationship. If you don't have trust, what do you have? Not much of a relationship, right? So it's important to understand failure almost always impacts others. Here, it impacted 36 lives gone. 36 men died. Why? Because of Achan's failure. 36 men's families impacted. Why? Because of Achan's failure. It's so important that we understand that sin is serious. That failure is guaranteed when we fail to stick to God's game plan, and that it will almost always impact others. Well, there are more that will be impacted, and we'll find that out in a little bit. Let's go back. Verse 5. At this, the hearts of the people melted. The hearts of what people? The Israelites, right? And if we look at the first 6 chapters, it talks about the hearts of the people melting, but it wasn't the Israelites, was it? It was the Canaanites. It was the people that occupied the promised land, what God had said to the Israelites, I'm going to give you this land, and I'm going to go before you, and I will take care of things. And so when they sent spies into Jericho, the spies came back, and they said, hey, the people's hearts are melting before the Lord. They've lost all hope. They've lost all courage. They're just sitting ducks waiting basically for us to take them over because their hearts have melted. And now things have flipped, and it's the Israelites whose hearts have melted in fear and become like water. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell face down to the ground before the ark of the Lord, remaining there till evening. The elders of Israel did the same and sprinkled dust on their heads. And Joshua said, alas. Everybody say alas. Alas is one of these words that we hardly ever say. How many of you say alas? Like, other than you just said it now because you're polite and you're going along with the pastor today and all of that. Okay, but other than like maybe when we say alas and did the Savior bleed and we sing that song. Or we're reading scripture and we come across something and it says, and Joshua said, alas. You see, there are words, especially words like in the English language, that are kind of like clothes in America, clothing styles, like bell bottoms, kind of like come and go, right? There's some words that kind of come and go. We don't really use them anymore. Or back in my high school days, I would buy jeans that were 4 inches longer than I really needed so I could roll them up. Sound like a bright idea, right? But how many of you did that? You pegged your jeans, right? You know, buy them longer than you really need them and roll them up. Not because, you know, your brother had longer legs than you did or whatever, but because you, like, we're trying to be cool. Like, fad. Alas. Anybody know what alas means? It sounds like, in some ways, it kind of means, like, finally is kind of what I thought at one point, but I started doing a little bit more. That's not what it is. It's somebody said, whoa. It's kind of like, it's not even really a word in the original translation. It's just kind of an exclamation. He's just saying, how many of you ever gone to the Lord and went, It's like, sovereign Lord. Why did you ever bring this people across the Jordan? Does this sound a little familiar, especially for those that have been following along? We did a good part of the book of Exodus, and now coming into Joshua, like, this is the Israelites' theme song. Why, Lord? Things were better back there. Why did you bring us into the wilderness? Why did you bring us out of Egypt? We were better off in Egypt. Oh, Lord, why did you bring us across the Jordan? We were better off on the other side of the Jordan. Now we're on the west side of the Jordan and we're losing people. We were better off on the east side of the Jordan. Oh, Lord. There's something happening here. Joshua's praying now. Did he pray before they went to battle? Keep that in mind. The Canaanites and the other people of the country, that Joshua continues in his prayer, will hear about this, and they will surround us and wipe out our name from the earth. What then will you do for your own great name? The Lord said to Joshua, I love this, stand up! What are you doing down on your face? Now, does this mean that God doesn't want us to bow before him, to kneel before him, to in anguish when we've suffered defeat, cry out to him? No. But there was something that needed to be done. And Joshua spending time on his knees wasn't going to get it done. There's a time to pray and there's a time to act. Joshua should have prayed and then acted on that prayer. And instead, now he finds himself praying and then being told to act. And here's what God says. In an important lesson that we're going to get to before we talk about what God says, failure is likely when we fail to seek God's game plan. Failure is likely when we fail to seek God's game plan. You see, Joshua just assumed. Like, you know what? God was with us in the Battle of Jericho. God's going to be with us in the Battle of AE. God gave us directions for the Battle of Jericho. We got our feet wet. We kind of understand now what it's like to go into battle and to do this. And hey, you know what? We're riding high. We just came off of this amazing victory. And they are overconfident. We don't even need to seek God's help on this one. We don't even need to ask God what his game plan is for this game, for this battle. We'll just figure this one out on our own. I mean, after all, God did give us a brain, right? So let's just use it. Now that'd be great, and I highly encourage you to use your brain. But we talked about last week, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge him, trust him, look to him, submit to him, and he will direct you or make your paths straight. Joshua and the Israelites didn't do that. they assumed God was with them. They assumed that victory was theirs. There's some things that happen when we assume. And one of those is we tend to be wrong. We run the risk of being wrong. And when you assume God's will without actually seeking it, you're very likely to find yourself in the middle of failure. Because failure is likely when we fail to seek God's game plan. So here's God's response. Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen. They have lied. They have put them with their own possessions. That is why the Israelites cannot stand against their enemies. They turn their backs and run because they have been made liable to destruction. I will not be with you anymore unless you destroy whatever among you is devoted to destruction. God's going back to covenant. You've broken covenant as a nation. You said, well, it was just one. It was Achan. Well, yeah, it was Achan. We'll get into that a little bit more in a moment. But also, really, Joshua didn't seek the Lord. Was just going out on his own. They've broken covenant. In a covenant, God has a number of if-then statements. We see it originally in Deuteronomy. And God makes a if-then statement. Basically, if you will abide by my laws, if you will set me apart as your God, then I will bless you. And God's bringing it back and giving really an if-then statement. If you'll take care of this trouble, Achan, then I'll be with you. But if you don't, I won't. So, verse 13, go consecrate the people. This sounds a lot like what we saw before they crossed the Jordan River, where God tells Joshua to tell the rest of them to consecrate themselves, for tomorrow he is going to do a great thing. Well, consecrate the people. Tell them, consecrate yourselves in preparation for tomorrow. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. There are devoted things among you, Israel. You cannot stand against your enemies until you remove them. Failure is guaranteed. You can't stand against them until you remove them. Early the next morning, Joshua had Israel come forward by tribes. So this is how God tells them, this is how we're going to take care of business. So the next morning, they come forward by tribes. Judah was chosen. The clans of Judah came forward, and the Zerahites were chosen. You remember going back to verse 1? This is the opposite order, right? Can you imagine being in Achan? Okay, we know the backstory, right? So we know Achan's the guilty party. Can you imagine Achan? Like, okay, that's my tribe. Okay. So one out of the 12, this isn't looking too good. And then it comes from the clans of Judah came forward and the Zerahites were chosen. Uh-oh. They got great-grandfather in there. Zerahites and then the Zimmerites. And then all of a sudden, Joshua and his family come forward, man by man, and Achan, trouble, son of Carmi, the son of Zimri, said, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah was chosen, guilty. God called him out in front of everybody. Good news for you today, I'm not going to call anybody out in front of anybody else. Truth be told, I probably could call out every single one of you. And probably every single one of you could call out me. Right? We've sinned. Achan sinned. He took the devoted things. And God tells Joshua that something's got to happen because of this. That when the guilty party is identified, they are to be killed. And we'll address that in just a little bit. Because that seems pretty harsh. I mean, he took some devoted things. What even did he take? Well, let's go back and find out some things real quickly. Then Joshua, verse 19, said to Achan, my son, give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, and honor him. So basically, acknowledge before God and tell the truth. This is basically, do you promise to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God. This is kind of one of those type of things. Okay, tell me what you have done. Do not hide it from me. Achan replied, it is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. This is what I have done. Follow this. Here we go. Verse 21. When I saw in the plunder a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver and a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. They are hidden in the ground inside my tent with the silver underneath. I'm going to go ahead and point out a few things while the words are on the screen. When I saw. When I saw. This is usually how sin will start. Desire. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong with desire. Most desires are relatively natural, God-given even. Like, how many of you have a desire to eat from time to time? Okay, that's God-given. Like, okay, oh, I need to eat. I need to make sure that I have some energy, a food source, so I can continue on. Okay, but desire, when it's fulfilled in an ungodly way, is bad. So we have desires. We have desire to eat. We have thirst desires. How many of you get thirsty occasionally? Like, I just need something to drink. And there's different kinds of desires. God's given us sexual desires. Sex isn't bad. Sex isn't wrong. As long as it's within the confines of God's ways, God's laws. As long as it's within the holy matrimony, sacred relationship of marriage, one man, one woman, sex is great. God says, be fruitful and multiply. I mean, God says that throughout Scripture. Like, there's nothing wrong with it when it's within the context of God's plan. But when you go outside of God's plan, we've got problems. So desire, Achan saw in the plunder a beautiful robe from Babylonia. So there's this desire, he sees this robe, which, whose robe is it? It's God's robe. It was to be devoted to him. It was to be burned because it wasn't something that was going to be redeemed. It wasn't redeemable. You're not going to make something that is unholy holy when it's something like a clothing garment. This is their culture. Gold and silver, that's something that can be redeemed. That's something that can be melted down or whatever. It can be refashioned for something for the Lord. Put in his treasury is what the desire was, the design. But he sees it. Let's go back. Plunder. Is that what it is? Was it plunder? No. So we have desire and then we have deception. When we're starting to fall for temptation, usually there's lies involved. There's lies like Satan tells us, and there's lies that we tell ourselves. It's not that big of a deal. Well, it's really like, should be mine anyway. I mean, like, possession is 9/10 of the law anyway, right? I mean, we lie to ourselves. We deceive ourselves, and we look to deceive others. So I saw it, and then I coveted it. I wanted it. I made a decision then and took them. So desire to deception, to a decision, and he took them. They are hidden in the ground inside my tent with the silver underneath. All of that to help us to understand that failure comes in stages. Failure comes in stages. In some ways, it's like in the book of James, chapter 1, it's like James went back and watched some tape, some game film, if you will. He went back and like, hey, let's look at Achan's story, and what do we see here? And he maps it out for us, and he basically mapped it out as I've just walked you through. Like, there's this desire and deception. We lie to ourselves, and we're deceived, and we fall for it. And then there's a decision. We act on that. And then there's death. The same pattern is found in Genesis chapter 3. We look at Adam and Eve. Eve saw, she desired, told herself a lie, bought the lie from Satan that God doesn't really want what's best for us, that God's just trying to keep something from us. I deserve this. This won't hurt anybody. This won't hurt me. Made a decision. She ate it. And with that came death. Now for Eve, it wasn't immediate death. For Achan, it was pretty much immediate. They took him out. They stoned him to death. They took his family and his livestock and they stoned them to death as well. And here's where it gets really tricky and a little bit difficult. And you go, well, where's the grace in that? Where's God's love in that? Where's justice in that? Well, let's back up just a little bit and let's look at a few things and try to see them through maybe a little bit of a different perspective. Did Achan have an opportunity to come clean before this day? I mean, just the day before, God says, go and consecrate yourselves. Set yourselves apart as holy. Like, get yourselves prepared to meet with the Lord. Did Achan do that? No. I think God in his mercy and his grace provided Achan an opportunity the day before he was called out in front of the whole tribe. In front of everybody. But he didn't take it. And so, what about the family? And the livestock? Well, the livestock I can't answer for, but the family, I think I have a little bit of an answer for. The stuff was hidden in his tent. Okay? If you understand what they had with them, they didn't have a lot. Therefore, in my mind, it would be pretty difficult to really hide something from your family. And some of you know this really well. There are things that other people don't outside your house don't know, but you know in your house what's going on. And there's sin in the camp. And there's sin in your tent, if you will. And there was sin in Achan's tent. And I believe his family knew about it. Surely there had to have been questions in their mind. Why is that pile of dirt there? What's been going on? Oh, I'm just doing a little remodeling, changing out the flooring. No. What's going on? Like, was that a Babylonian robe I saw you kind of trancing around in, prancing around in yesterday? Like, what's going on? Like, did? Oh, I think they knew. I think they knew. They weren't guilty by taking it, but they allowed that sin to continue. That's my personal opinion. Scripture doesn't completely speak to it. Whatever the case, it is a couple reminders. There's some reminders here. One, again, sin is serious, right? Again, failure usually, almost always, will impact others. It impacted his family. But there's also some great news coming up as we continue on. Over Achan, they heaped up a large pile of rocks. We'll skip down to verse 26, which remains to this day. Then the Lord turned from his fierce anger. Therefore, that place has been called the Valley of Achor ever since. Achor and Achan, if you do the research, they actually come from the same root. It's like it was named after Achan. It's the Valley of Trouble, which sounds awesome, doesn't it? How many of you would love to have something named after you, and it's not in a positive light? The plunder, you know, like the blunder of, like, man, named after when you did something wrong. But here's the silver lining. Here's the message of hope. In all this destruction and all this failure, we see something. One, we see that God turned from his fierce anger. We go back to if-then statements. Like 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. Where God says, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and heal their land. You see, God's still the same God. He's still the same covenant God. He's seeking our best, but for our best, we have to seek him and his ways, and we have to stick to his game plan. He says, we're done with ours. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Not about my game plan anymore. Not about doing things my way. That's pride, by the way, right? I did it my way. That's pride. And it usually will mean failure. Then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. Proverbs 28:13 says, whoever conceals their sin does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. Here's what I want us to see in this last verse. Failure doesn't have to be final. Failure doesn't have to be final. The Valley of Achor, by the way, is mentioned a couple more times in Scripture. Hundreds of years after Achan's sin and them heaping up this pile of stone, very similar to when they made a pile of stone as they crossed the Jordan River as a reminder of God's faithfulness, of God's power, of God's provision, how he allowed them to walk across on dry ground even though the Jordan River was at flood stage. And here they have a great reminder of what life is like when you don't follow God's game plan.